Good morning, I'm Rain Musngi. Here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. visits quake-hit areas in northern Luzon. At least five are confirmed dead in Wednesday's tremor. And a former presidential advisor blames the inaction of health officials for the loss of 5.1 billion pesos worth of COVID-19 vaccines. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. visits areas devastated by Wednesday's magnitude 7 earthquake. The palace earlier this morning said the president was headed to Abra, the epicenter of the quake. He's joined by Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos and Social Welfare Secretary Erwin Tulfo, among others. Marcos was supposed to visit the province Wednesday, but he decided to postpone the trip, saying he may only disrupt ongoing relief efforts. Marcos earlier said he is not yet inclined to declare a state of calamity or a state of emergency in northern Luzon. State seismologists record over 600 aftershocks following the magnitude 7 earthquake that hit Luzon Wednesday morning. The Philippine Institute of Volcanology and Seismology warns aftershocks may continue in the coming days. Local officials in Abra are already bracing themselves for another possible strong tremor.
Turned inside their homes because of there are only slight damages. However, the barangay councils were activated. So we have been giving advisories during the aftershock. Everybody is mandated to go outside their homes and go on open ground. We still do not have electricity as of the moment. It is not just for safety precautions. I believe that there were damaged lines. Oh.
The quake left one person dead and over 80 people injured in Abra. Several homes, buildings, and roads were also damaged. Four towns remain isolated. Meanwhile, residents in Bangget Town are appealing for help, saying their potable water supply is running out. They claim they have yet to receive any help from the local or national government. In Ilocos Sur, one person is confirmed to have died in the quake, while 34 others were injured. Ilocos Sur Governor Jeremiah Singson said around 6,000 individuals or over 400 families were affected. About 65 aftershocks have been recorded since Wednesday morning.
Nahihirapan din kasi tuloy-tuloy yung aftershock pa. So pansamantala na suspended po lahat, pati opisina. Lahat ng private offices at saka government offices, mga eskwelahan, suspended po muna lahat yan. Ang pinapapasok lang namin yung mga ating mga department heads, mga PDRRMO, PNP, Fire Bureau, yung mga frontliners.
Singson adds they are expecting President Marcos to visit the province this morning. Three people were injured in Baguio City following Wednesday's magnitude 7 earthquake. Among them, a student who fell from the second floor of her dorm as she was trying to use the fire exit. Mayor Benjamin Magalong says she is conscious and under constant monitoring at the hospital. Meanwhile, there have been no reports of major structural damage. Magalong says classes in all levels and work have resumed after roads were cleared of debris.
The two other main roads leading to the city of Baguio from the south, and I'm referring to Naguilian and Marcos Highway. They're now open. Yesterday, only one lane of Marcos Highway was open, but it was already cleared last night. So two lanes of Marcos Highway are already passable. In fact, we're already accepting tourists.
Wednesday's strong tremor claimed the lives of two persons in the provinces of Benguet and Kalinga. In Buyagan, La Trinidad, Benguet, a construction worker died when he was hit by falling debris. According to the La Trinidad police, work was ongoing in the three-level structure when the tremor started. The victim was declared dead on the spot. In Balbalan, Kalinga, a construction worker also died after falling off a rock netting during the earthquake. The National Telecommunications Commission orders telco companies to provide free call and charging services in quake-hit areas. The order is valid until August 5th. In response, Globe Telecom deployed a station offering free calls, charging, and Wi-Fi in Abra. It was set up at the Banggit Plaza near Lanangilang town, the epicenter of the earthquake. PLDT Smart also deployed teams to set up free call stations in Abra and Ilocos Sur. The Social Welfare Department says it prepared 10 million pesos to help residents in quake-hit Abra. Secretary Erwin Tulfo himself flew to the province on Wednesday to assess the situation there. He says his agency will shoulder hospital bills and burial expenses of quake victims. He also distributed 2,000 relief food packs.
Meron po kang pamimigay ngayon ko na 1 million na cash doon sa mga naapektuhan. May parating pa ako na another 5 million po. Handa po ang gobyerno, handa po ang DSWD. May pagkain po tayo. Kaya po nating sustain masking ilang araw po.
The Budget Department says the Marcos administration is ready to fund disaster relief efforts in quake-hit areas. Budget Secretary Amena Pangandaman confirms the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Program Fund is available to tap. There is also a quick response fund that may be mobilized if necessary. She says the disaster relief fund may be used for the reconstruction, rehabilitation, and other services following natural calamities this year. The international community expresses support for the Philippines following Wednesday's quake. China's ambassador to Manila says his country is ready to aid the Philippines in its recovery efforts.
My prayer goes to all Filipinos for their safety. I hope there won't be any casualty and damages. And if there is anything that we can be of help to the Filipino people, we will be ready.
In separate tweets, the ambassador of Japan and the European Union delegation to the Philippines expressed their sympathies to affected residents. The French embassy also extended prayers for the quake victims. The Education Department says over 8,000 schools are affected across Luzon due to the earthquake in Abra, 35 of which were damaged. That's based on the initial assessment of the Philippines' Disaster Management Agency. The report also revealed it would cost 228.5 million pesos to reconstruct and rehabilitate these damaged schools. The DepEd says it has called for an emergency meeting with the regional and division disaster officials of the affected regions so they can coordinate their response. It's also looking into the number of affected learners, teachers, and non-teaching personnel. The initial cost of damage to national roads pegged at 59.23 million pesos. That's according to the Public Works Department, which says assessment of other infrastructure damage are still ongoing. The agency has also cleared and reopened 13 out of 22 national road sections and bridges in the Cordillera Administrative Region and Ilocos Region that were previously closed off to traffic due to debris following the earthquake. In other news, the election of several lawmakers to key posts at the House of Representatives not sitting well with some of their colleagues. RG Cruz gives us the latest on the reorganization at the upper and lower chambers of Congress.
Albay 1st District Representative Edsel Lagman and new House Minority Leader Marcelino Libana did not mince words against each other after Lagman flagged Libana's election as a minority leader, who he claimed was handpicked by the majority.
Mr. Speaker, distinguished colleagues, let me start by expressing my disappointment and disenchantment in the new House leaderships and the new administrations perpetuating the practice of anointing the majority's minority leader. This is an open secret, a brutal fact.
In this August chamber, we are required to observe proper decorum. We are required to observe proper parliamentary language and proper parliamentary courtesy, Mr. Speaker. We have to go to our Constitution, Mr. Speaker, for a veteran legislator to stand there and give some insinuations to the members of minority, if not put into proper place, will not be good for our chamber.
Lagman cites the badges of interference, such as when Libanan thanked the majority after his election, taking his oath before the speaker, and Libanan asking for the plenary's approval when he picked the minority's representatives to the House committees. Libanan no longer responded to Lagman. Kabataan Partylist Representative Raul Manuel meanwhile flagged the election of presidential son Ilocos Norte 1st District Representative Sandro Marcos as senior deputy majority leader. But Representative Margarita Nograles fired back, insisting on Marcos's qualification for the job, citing his knowledge and experience from understudying at the majority leader's office when his uncle, the current speaker, had that post. Albay Representative Joey Salceda says being the son of the president makes Representative Marcos an asset to the House and its members.
Hindi mo na kailangan duman sa AES. So hindi mo na kailangan i-filter pa yung messaging. So kung anong problema sa House, makakarap niya agad kay Presidente. So mas mapapabilis po ang legislative meal.
Former Senator, now Batangas Representative Ralph Recto, Pampanga Representative Aurelio Don Gonzalez, and Cebu Representative Duke Frasco were elected to become the 7th, 8th, and 9th Deputy Speaker of the House. The Speaker's wife, Tingog Partylist Representative Yeda Romualdez, would be in charge of the House's institutional purse as Chair of the House Committee on Accounts, while a key ally of the Speaker, Acobico Representative Zaldi Co, would be in charge of the national budget as Chair of the House Committee on Appropriations. Other chairmen of key House committees have been named as well. At the Senate, Senator Francis Tolentino now heads the powerful Blue Ribbon Committee, Senator Sani Angara, the Finance Committee, and Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, the Ways and Means Committee. Two committees, Foreign Relations and Social Justice, Welfare and Rural Development, went to the President's sister, Senator Aimee Marcos. R.G. Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Senator Sonny Angara, in step with President Marcos's goal to build specialty hospitals like the Philippine Heart Center in geographically isolated regions and provinces in the country. It's one of Angara's priority bills this 19th Congress. He hopes the existing medical scholarship law will help in supplying the needed manpower for these health facilities.
I think what's often cited is we don't have enough specialist doctors to man some of these. If we build these hospitals, where do we get the doctors? Not just doctors, but also trained nurses, trained barangay health workers all over the country. They're barangay health workers, but many of them are need to be upskilled. No, so there's really a need for an overarching and a comprehensive study of our health system, whether it's personnel, the dispersal of the competitiveness of their compensation.
Angara, who chairs the Senate Finance Committee, estimates it will cost around 10 to 15 billion pesos a year to build additional health facilities.
Traditionally, there's a Health Facilities Enhancement Program Fund. It's called the HFEP. And there's usually 10 to 20 billion pesos there. So it's really a matter of having very focused spending. We can be creative about how we fund our healthcare system. No, because there's the national government. Many people are just looking at the national government to shoulder these costs. But you also have the local governments. There's a new development in local government finance, which is the Mandanas doctrine or the Mandanas decision, which gives more resources to the health personnel. You also have PPP. So there's also the private sector.
We're taking a quick break. Still to come, U.S. President Joe Biden now back at the Oval Office following his bout with COVID-19. That's next on The Rundown. Stay tuned. The Philippines records over 2,700 new COVID cases. Active infections now stand at over 27,000. Almost 1,000 new infections were detected in Metro Manila, prompting local officials to ramp up booster vaccinations. The cities of San Juan and Makati will start offering second booster shots to more groups starting today. People aged 50 and above and immunocompromised adults are now allowed to get their second booster shots following the green light from the health department. The alleged inaction of the health department's Health Technology Assessment Council, or HTAC, to blame for the expiration of over 5.1 billion pesos worth of COVID-19 vaccines purchased by the private sector. That's according to former presidential advisor for entrepreneurship, Joey Concepcion. He says the losses could have been prevented if only authorities acted fast on repeated requests to expand the second booster coverage. Concepcion says they've been calling for that as early as March.
I would have thought that the DOH leadership could have stepped in, no, and really tried to intervene. What changed the mind of HTAC today? I don't know. Maybe a lot of pressure coming from from us. Mm-hmm. Maybe finally they saw the vaccines are going to expire. But the DOH secretary should be able to overrule any of these committees. These are supposed to be advisory committees anyway.
Concepcion also doubling down on his call to start the process for vaccine makers to apply for a certificate of product registration. That would make COVID-19 vaccines commercially available, allowing the public to purchase shots easily. Meanwhile, U.S. President Joe Biden now out of isolation after a battle with COVID-19. According to the president's physician, Biden completed a course of Paxlovid antiviral pills and has already tested negative for the virus twice. In a speech at the Rose Garden, Biden said his quick recovery from COVID-19 should inspire Americans to take advantage of free vaccines and treatments.
Bottom line, when my predecessor got COVID, he had to get helicoptered to Walter Reed Medical Center. He was severely ill. Thankfully, he recovered. When I got COVID, I worked from upstairs of the White House in the offices upstairs and for that five-day period. The difference is vaccinations, of course. You don't need to be president to get these tools used for your defense. In fact, the same booster shots, the same at-home test, the same treatment that I got is available to you. My administration has made sure that all Americans across the country, from all walks of life, have free access to those tools.
Japan's daily COVID-19 cases hit a record high of over 209,000 as the country continues to battle its seventh wave of infections. More than half of the nation's 47 prefectures also logged record numbers of cases on Wednesday, including Hokkaido and Kyoto. Despite that, the country has not imposed mobility restrictions. That's as Prime Minister Fumio Kishida seeks to strike a balance between socioeconomic activities and measures to contain the spread of the virus. Two new studies bolster arguments COVID-19 originated at an animal market in Wuhan, China. The first paper analyzed the geographical pattern of the first COVID cases in 2019 using mapping tools. It found that the cases were tightly clustered around a seafood wholesale market in Wuhan. The second paper, meanwhile, focused on the early evolution of the virus. It concluded the virus unlikely circulated widely among humans prior to November 2019. Both studies have been vetted by scientific peer review and have been published. The World Health Organization's technical lead for COVID welcomed the publication of the studies, but he said it is critical to continue the study of the origins of the pandemic to prevent and mitigate future outbreaks and epidemics. In business, the U.S. Federal Reserve continues its aggressive campaign to cool inflation. Policymakers unanimously backed a 75 basis point hike. It was a second three-quarter point rate increase and the fourth hike this year. The Fed noted there are signs the U.S. economy is slowing, but it asserts failure to tame inflation is not an option. Fed Chairman Jerome Powell also signaled plans to continue hiking rates while staving off recession.
I do not think the U.S. is currently in a recession. And the reason is there are just too many areas of the economy that are performing, too well. And of course, I would point to the labor market in particular. While another unusually large increase could be appropriate at our next meeting, That is a decision that will depend on the data we get between now and then.
The Fed began raising interest rates from near zero in March. Policymakers have picked up the pace since, as the U.S. deals with the strongest surge in consumer prices in more than four decades. Turkey formally opens a joint coordination center in Istanbul for Ukrainian grain exports. It's part of a United Nations-backed deal to resume shipments that were halted after Russia invaded Ukraine back in February. Under the deal, both Moscow and Kyiv vowed safe passage for the grains with the creation of corridors in three Ukrainian ports. Up to 20 million tons of grain are tapped or trapped in ports due to the Russian blockade. This has led to food shortages and soaring prices of wheat across the globe. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is attending a situation briefing in Quakit Abra. Let's listen in.
Provide relief assistance and comfort to our beloved Abrajos. Thank you, sir, Mr. President. Your presence here, as well as the heads of the agencies who are with you, give us comfort. Malaking bagay po ito sa amin. Salamat ng marami sa mga tulong na pumapasok na at papasok pa para sa ating mga kababayan Abrino. Of course, we continue to receive update our people on the ground. There is so much change, damage, so many injured, many. Pero pangako namin, ang Abra ay babangon. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you, sir, for the warm welcome. Next, to give an update on the effects of the earthquake, is ASEC Bernardo Rapelito R. Alejandro IV of NDRRMC.
Good morning, Mr. President.
Good morning.
To the members of the Cabinet and to the Speaker, Speaker Romualdez, Senator Annie Marcos, to the Governor, and to the other local officials and members of the RDRMC, allow me to present the updates on the magnitude 7 earthquake in Northern Luzon. Scope of my presentation is as follows: the situation overview, monitored effects, and actions taken. Let me begin with the situation overview. Shown is the latest earthquake information from PBOX detailing the occurrence of earthquake at around 8:43 yesterday at Tayong Abra with a magnitude of 7.0. The highest intensity recorded is intensity 7. Also, based on records from PBOX, as of 2 a.m. this morning, there were already 798 aftershocks recorded in Abra. 161 were plotted, while 22 were felt. The magnitudes range from 1.5 to 5.4. Change in the number of aftershocks recorded was due to the validation made by PBOX. In terms of effects, for the affected population, a total of 4,969 families or 20,091 persons are affected in 110 barangays in Regions 1 and Car. In terms of casualties, there are 5 dead and 131 injured. In terms of damage to infrastructure, there are damage reported in Ilocos Sur. Also, 61 schools were reported as damaged, as well as 3 bridges. As of reporting time, the cost of damage to infrastructure is 33.8 billion in Ilocos region alone. To date, the concerned agencies and regional offices are still gathering reports on the damage to agriculture and other assets. For houses, a total of 349 houses were damaged in Car and Region 1. For roads and bridges, there are 22 roads closed to traffic in Caldera Region and one road in Cagayan Valley Region. Several areas in Car also experienced power interruption. While the whole province of Ilocos Sur experienced power interruptions but was immediately restored at 2 p.m. yesterday. In the Caldera, most of the earthquake effects were reported in Abra and Benguet as shown. Also shown are the effects in Kalinga, Ifugao, and Mountain Province. Here are some photos capturing the extent of damage in the region. Now, for the actions taken, the NDRIMC conducted its emergency meeting with the affected regions via BTC since yesterday. The virtual EOC was activated and red alert was raised at the NDRIM OC. The NDRIMC directive was signed by the chairperson, was issued for Luzon regions on the reiteration of response actions. PBOX also conducted continuous assessment and organized its quick response teams. A total of 2 emergency alerts and warning messages were issued. This is in relation to the no tsunami alert. Specifically, the NDRIMC has directed its response cluster to monitor the situation, provide assistance as needed, and account all actions taken. Shown are the summary of actions taken by the response cluster. For search, rescue, and retrieval cluster, this is led by the Armed Forces of the Philippines. As shown, we have standby assets that were deployed and also on standby for use. For camp coordination and camp management, protection and food and non-food items cluster, which is led by the DSWD, they have a standby relief amounting to 1.3 billion ready for augmentation. For emergency telecoms cluster led by DICT, as shown, they're doing ongoing restoration together with the commercial telcos. For the shelter cluster, this is led by the DSHUD. They have prepared shelter assistance with the help of partner agencies. For the health cluster, this is led by DOH. They have provided medicines and other medical supplies to the affected LGUs. For the education clusters, this is led by the DepEd. They reported around 61 damaged schools and 116 damaged classrooms, and the assessment is still ongoing. For the logistics cluster, this is led by the OCD. We have available stockpiles ready for augmentation when needed. For the law and order cluster, this is led by the PNP. They have deployed security forces around the different evacuation centers and have around 1,290 personnel on standby. For the management of the dead and missing, this is led by the DILG. They are doing the verification of the casualties of this event. Then we have the Philippine International Humanitarian Assistance Cluster, which is led by the DFA. They are monitoring offers of assistance. So far, we have received offer of assistance from Japan, specifically for search, rescue, and retrieval, and other emergency supplies. The AFP also conducted its immediate aerial reconnaissance for rapid damage assessment over Abra, Bigan, and other shoreline of La Union area. Based on the assessment, there were minor damage spotted at Bigan Cathedral and Bell Tower, as well as road damage due to landslide. No other significant observations or assessments were made. Here is the detailed report from the AFP for aircraft S-70. 70, as shown. They flew over Abra yesterday. Also, here is the detailed report from the AFP for aircraft S-76A, which flew over Vigan and La Union also yesterday. As for the regions and the local government units, they have conducted rescue and retrieval operations in affected areas. The regions and the local government units also provided assistance to affected families. They initiated the conduct of clearing operations, and presently, they are doing the assessment and data validation. With this, we'd like to inform the President that the response is managed at the local and regional levels with the support from outside regions, local government units, and other national government agencies. The NDRMC is continuously monitoring and on standby for specific needs that may arise. That ends my briefing, Mr. President.
Thank you, ASEC Alejandro.
Thank you.
At this point, may we hear the President's guidance.
Well, let's start. Good morning, everyone. I'd just like to start by clarifying some of the parts of the report. Number one, power has been restored everywhere. Wala nang area na nawalan ng power na hindi pa bumalik ang power, o meron pa rin. Yung mga isolated na bayan at dito sa Abra, the seven towns in the mountains, ano?
Yes, sir. Not all towns have power already, sir. Hindi pa po lahat.
But when do we anticipate na na bumalik na? Ayan. Tama-tama ang ating mga... Yes, I wanted that. I saw them. That's why I wanted to ask.
Good morning, Mr. President.
Good morning.
My name is Loreto Chavez Jr. I'm the General Manager of Abreco.
Good morning.
Please allow our technical assist to give you a brief report regarding
please
po sa ano, extent ng damages ng Abreco.
Magandang umaga po, Mr. President.
Good morning.
As of this early morning, sir, is all 26 towns ng Abra may power na po, although there are some laterals po na wala. Katulad po, halimbawa po, yung isang transformer na sira, definitely po, wala po. Pero yung backbone line po, buong Abra meron na po, sir.
So, yung capability ninyo, capacity ninyo, bago ng lindol, ano, nasa 95% pa kayo, parang ganun. Naibalik na ninyo.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It's
yes,
about
sir
in the, ano,
yes,
so,
sir.
Significant. The next area I wanted to talk to ask about, dahil hindi masyadong maliwanag, was the communication. Hindi pa ba ang pagkaintindi ko from the DICT is that the globe is fully functioning. Who can we see? Is globe fully functioning and SMART is also almost fully functioning? All right. Okay na for the province of Abra. Talagang inaantay lang niya nang the power. Okay, of course. So Sec Erwin, what are the outstanding issues yet para sa assistance doon sa ating mga naging biktima who are that's another question I wanted to ask. Usually in the disaster reports there is one area where you give the number of totally destroyed houses and partially destroyed. Do we have that number, those numbers? Yes, please, para alam natin what we have to, what we are dealing with.
At this, Mr. President, at this point, we're continuing the assessment, and right now, as per 6 o'clock a.m., we have 28 totally damaged houses and 2,362 partially pero latataas pa to, sir, as the report sa ano, kasi i-reach out pa natin yung mga outlying barrios, Mr. President.
Yusek Solidum, are we allowing them already? Are we allowing them already to go back into their homes, to at least the engineers, to inspect if they are safe? Is it already safe for people to, at least hindi pa muna yung resident, kundi yung mga mag-inspeksyon, to declare safe the
Yes
structure?
Po. Kung declared talagang structurally safe po yung mga building, pwede na. But people should be ready how to respond properly during aftershocks. Kasi malakas pa po ang posibleng aftershock. And just to brief po ang mga local government units, we expect aftershocks to continue for several weeks. Pero the first 3 days po ang marami, and hopefully, pababa na siya.
For example, the hospital, when ayaw pa nilang pumasok ngayon because it's still, it might still be unsafe and baka magka-aftershock. When is it safe for our people to go in to make the inspection and then start the repairs?
Yung inspection po can be done right away.
Can be done right
away. Yes po.
Who will perform the
engineer po, public works and engineers.
Public works,
Ninyo.
Public works ang
gawa. Yes po.
They will do the inspections. All right. The other, I think sa dun sa human victims, yung mga homeless, how many people have been rendered homeless? Oh. Oh yes, director. Oh, oh. Ano
yes,
yung,
Mr. Yung, President,
yung statistic for homeless.
Ang bali ang actually ang nakalagay ho dito natin is totally is 28, pero ang partially, so yeah, assess pa natin 'yan is 2,362.
Saan ngayon yung mga resident na 'yan?
Ito po ay covered po ito yung mga marami rito po sa Abra, tapos meron din tayo sa Kalinga, sa Benguet.
Hindi, pagka homeless sila, saan sila tinakbo? Saan
ano
sila dinala? Where did you evacuate them to?
Dalawa po yan, evacuation centers o meron silang napuntahan ng mga kamag-anak sa
yes,
na ibang lugar.
Go, Vice Joy.
Mr. President, we opted to accommodate all our evacuees sa open area like yung ganitong structure. All of the LGUs in the province po, we have evacuation centers, but it's not advisable to accommodate inside the evacuation center since meron pa po mga aftershock. Kaya yung mga merong mga basketball courts, we set up through the SWD, we set up modular tents for everyone.
All right. How many now are under those are in those evacuation centers?
Actually, sir, we are. We have 1,000 modular tents coming in, dumating na ito. And another 1,000 coming from Region 2, interoperability. So parating ho ito, mga modular tents, pero meron na ho kaming na-set up dito sa Banggued.
I'm looking for the number so that the DSWD knows how to prepare. Ilan ang aalagaan, ilan yung papakainin, that's your basics. How long will we have to be keeping them in the evacuation center? All of this para alam ng DSWD kung ano yung trabaho nila. Yes,
yes, sir. If I may, sir. I see Faustina, sir. Sir, we have a figure here. We have the reports coming in from the affected regions. We have a total of 400,969 families or 20,000 persons, more or less, that are affected in 110 barangays in Region 1 and the Cordillera Administrative Region. Inside evacuation centers, 31 evacuation centers ang nabilang natin, sir. We have around 2,312 families and in Regions 1 and Cordillera Administrative Region. Then outside evacuation centers, yung mga tao na temporarily staying sa relatives nila or friends na naglagay ng mga tents sa labas ng bahay, we have around 413 families or 1,637 persons, sir. The whole sir, regions, far end Region 1, sir. So these are the numbers, sir.
All right, thank you, sir.
Sir, let me add to that.
Yung affected families po, basing as of 6 a.m. kanina, sir, is around 4,969 dito po. Persons, to translate that in individuals, like 20,091. Nasa evacuation centers po natin ng families is 2,312. And na persons, yung bawat tao, sir, is 8,314. Outside evacuation centers, sir, yung wala po sa mga evac centers sila, pero dyan po sa tabi ng bahay nila, sa labas po, yung iba opted to return home. 413 families po. Persons po is 1,657, Mr. President. Damaged houses po, partial is 9. Totally damaged po as 349 so far. But it might still go up, sir, according to the LGU.
All right. Mabuti na lang. You don't see any of this from the air. All right. So that is going to be at the very least. Kasi dati, as you say, tataas pa yung number niyan.
Yes, sir.
Habang makatanggap na tayo ng report, lalo na yung mga malalayo. So I think we are prepared for that kind of number.
We are, sir. Basing on your instruction po kasi during the SONA, sir, morning pa lamang, we have already deployed all these food packs, yung prepositioning. Hindi lang po food packs, pati po 9 food items have been prepositioned already, sir, sa mga provinces. Kagaya po dito sa Abra, sir, nag-preposition na po kami. Nung morning pa lang po ng SONA ninyo, pinadala na po lahat dito. Ang anticipation namin, sir, was flood and landslide, hindi po earthquake. Pero we have already distributed, sir.
Yeah, that's what we were worried about in the very beginning, na umulan, that will make the situation work. So, we do what we usually do, work together with the local government so that we can make sure na walang nangangailangan na hindi natin nabigyan ng tulong. That's just the LGUs are always the ones, the municipal mayors, the governors, the vice governor, ay kayong nakakaalam kung ano, what the situation is on the ground. So our communications is back, yung kuryente is back. Wala namang nasira na water supply. Yes, and I mean.
Yes, with all due respect, Region 1 is not completely back in terms of power. And even in Batac, there was no power this morning in certain barangays such as Kilingsur and those beside and surrounding MMSU. The same goes for certain coastal towns. They're still in the dark.
As I understand it, even in Ilocos Sur, meron pa rin yata. La Union, meron pa yata.
Yes, that's correct.
May mga lugar pang wala eh.
We're having some problems in Cagayan as well due to all sorts of electrical issues. At may mga transformer na bulok na pumutok na rin.
Well, that unfortunately, yung pag-inspeksyon ng linya will take time. But I think we will just have to do as much as we can as quickly as possible. Of course, that's going to be for the key for our relief efforts. Lahat ng gagawin natin, we have to be able to communicate and we have to be able to operate. So we need. That's why inuna ko yung dalawang yun to find out what our capabilities are. All right. So the next since we've paid attention already to the human aspect of it. Well, there's one more question I had in terms of service. Wala namang nagka-problema na putulan ng water supply? Meron din. Oh, that's something that we have to... We're here in Banggit? Oh, anong nangyari?
Dahil siguro sa movement ng soil or whatever, kaya yung mga lines ng water system po nagkaka-problema.
Well, that again is actually even more of a priority than communications and power. That's something that has to be restored immediately. So we have a representative from Public Works here or from the Water Authority?
The Office of Civil Defense. Regarding sorry, water, sir, water supply, if I may, sir. The whole province of Abra needs 300,000 bottles of water, drinking water. Yes. So initially, I coordinated with the Office of Civil Defense Central Office. So may parating na po na initial na 500 boxes of distilled water. So ang kailangan talaga, sir, is 6,250 boxes, 48 for a total of 300,000 bottles. Initial po. So we are doing an initial, naglo-loading na po sa central office ng Office of Civil Defense. It will be coming anytime this day.
But are the systems that were damaged, are they undergoing repair? Because we cannot be providing bottles of water for too long.
Sir, good morning. I'm Director Kadhafi Tanggol from BPWH CAR, sir.
Oh, there you are. Okay.
With regards to the water system, sir, the maintenance and the operation were delegated to the local waterworks now. So, they have the responsibility for the maintenance, sir.
Cannot provide assistance to the local government para maging mas mabilis?
Sir, the first instruction of Secretary Bunuan for us is to make all our national roads and bridges passable.
Correct, yes.
So we started dun sa, we have 22 road closures, and then for CAR, we still have 3 na road closure. So after which, we will assist also the local government units in clearing their local roads, yun ang instruction of Secretary Bunuan, which we are doing now. And nagpalabas din sir ng assessment team si Secretary Bunuan, both from the central office and from the regional office, to assess the situation of our infra and other buildings, kasama na yung sa school buildings, hospitals, and other government facilities. So this assessment, sir, is ongoing na since yesterday, and we will submit the report tomorrow, Friday. Yun ang binigay sa amin na deadline, sir.
All right, but we have to put together a plan to restore the actual water systems.
Yes.
As quickly as possible. Yes, Anna.
Yes, Mr. President, if I may. I'm sending up a solar purifier, and we found in Ilocos Norte that those are very helpful. You don't have the disposal of plastic and all the other issues that surround distilled water. So perhaps the national government can begin to procure solar purifiers for these disasters. In the meantime, I'm sending one to ABRA.
Very well.
Mr. President, sir.
One of the things that we have found useful in all of the disaster, pagka water supply ang nagiging problema, are the water purifying systems that are very simple. You've seen them before, yung nasa balde. And then they have a filter. We should procure more of those because immediately water is always going to be a problem. Para hindi, you know, things like cholera, diphtheria will come into play. So tignan natin na mabuti yan. I know already of a source where we can immediately get them. There is a it is actually an aid agency, and yun lang ang trabaho nila. Nagpo-provide sila nung ginamit natin sa
yun. Mr. President?
Yes, I think that's the NGO called Spring that was very present in Yolanda in Tacloban.
That yung maliliit, maganda niyan is it's sufficient for one to supply 100 people per day. So if the barangay has 4, 5, 6 of them, at least may tubig na.
We also have an indigenous technology using the Burnai to filter by layer the impure water into potable.
Well, we have to try everything. Basta tumayagi, pakuluan lang ng konti, just to be sure that everything is safe. Yes,
Mr. President, you know sinabi ni Senator Amy, tama po yun. In fact, MMDA is now here with 10 water purifiers. We've issued, ginamit po namin ito nung huling Odette sa Bohol at sa Samar. So naka-standby na po sila. Siguro solar powered din po sila. Lalagay lang ito sa isang poso o kung saan, at it could really pwede mag-supply sa isang barangay. Andiyan na po the 10 teams.
Ang isang barangay. How many?
Ito po ay 10 makina
ano
po ang dala po nila.
Sa truck?
Ano po ito, portable po ito, sir. Very portable. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Na-test na po, na gamit na po namin ito, and magdadala. They're now here at the Capitol, the MMDA Search.
Kailangan natin lahat yan. But I'm particularly interested doon sa that simple purification system. Because we don't know how long it's going to take. So iiwanan, mabuti meron silang water supply. Iwanan na namin sa inyo diyan. Kasi ito, when more or less there is a supply. But we cannot depend only on water bottles. After a while, And then, makikita ninyo daming plastic bigla sa barangay ninyo. Maglilinis kayo ng husto. So all right. So yes, those are the critical parts I think to support the victims. In the meantime, hanggat sila'y makabalik. All right. So I would like to see a report on the infrastructure damage in the roads, bridges, then also from the irrigation, kung tinamaan yung mga irrigation system natin, and what the damage is. So maybe the Public Works can give us a report on the...
Good morning, sir.
Yes.
We will start with Cordillera, sorry, and the next reporting will be by Argitan of Region 1. Mm-hmm. So, for this particular incident, we were able to deploy 408 equipment and 2,228 manpower. That's for a car and Region 1. Next slide, please. And then, sir, these are a series of pictures of the landslides that happened in Cordillera. This is under the Benguet province. Next slide, please. This one is in Marcos Highway, sir. And as of this writing, it's already passable, two-lane passable. Next slide. Yan, sir, yung sa Marcos Highway, it's now passable. Next slide. That's still in Marcos Highway. The same one section lang yan, sir. Next slide. This one, sir, is in Nueva Vizcaya Road. As you can see in the slide, yung portion na may intervention, walang nangyaring slides, but ito sa section na malapit sa cameraman, wala pang intervention na nagawa, so there's a slide. Next, please. This is the same section, sir, in Nueva Vizcaya Road, which is now open, two-lane. Next slide. Another section in Nueva Vizcaya Road. Again, this section, sir, is open na rin as of now. Next slide. Another section, sir, in Andres Acop-Cosalan Road. This one, sir, is open lang siya ng one lane. We need more intervention for this one. Next slide. Yan. So, passable na po siya, sir, for one lane lang. Next slide. So, this one, sir, again, is in Andres Acop-Cosalan Road. It's now passable. Next slide. Next slide, please. This one, sir, is in Governor Bado Dangwan National Road in Kapangan. It's now passable din, sir. Next slide. This one, another section in Governor Bado Dangwan National Road. It's now passable, sir. Next slide. This one, sir, is again in Governor Bado Dangwan National Road. It's now passable. Next slide. Again, sir, in Governor Bado Dangwan National Road at Kibungan, it's now passable. Next slide. Another section of the Governor Bado Dangwan National Road in Ampusungan, Bacon, Benguet, it's now passable, sir. Next slide. This one, sir, is in Baguio Bontoc Road. There are series of slides that happen in that road section. Next slide. The same road section, sir, in Baguio Bontoc Road. Cleared na ito, sir. It's passable. Next slide. Again, in Baguio Bontoc Road, sir. Sir, ganyan kalalaki yung mga nahuhulog na bato dito sa Cordillera. So you can just imagine the danger that... Ito yung kinakatatakutan ng mga taga-Cordillera pagka dumadaan sila sa ating kalsada, sir. Next slide. This one is in Alab section, Bontoc Mountain Province. Next slide. This one is in Bunyan section. Passable na rin ito, sir. Next slide. Next slide. Again, in Baguio Bontoc Road, Lukib section, Mountain Province, sir. Now it's passable. Next slide, please. And this one, sir, the next slide. Next slide. Again, in Baguio Bontoc Road, sir. This is in Mount Data Cliff, Bauco. Ito, sir, yung hindi pa passable. Ongoing pa yung clearing at this section. Next slide. Again, katabi lang nito nung isa, sir, pero this part ng doon sa Mount Data Cliff is open na. Next slide. This one is the Mountain Province to Ilocoso Road. Next slide. Passable na rin siya, sir. Next slide. This one, sir, again in Mountain Province to Cagayan via Tabuk Inrail Road and Makutiti section. Passable na rin siya, sir. Next slide. So those are series of pictures, sir, that we were able to collect. And as of this morning, sir, 7 a.m., we still have three remaining closed na road section. This is the Ifugao, sa Ifugao, sir, the Kiangan Tinok Bugyas Road, which we expect to be open bukas ng 5 p.m. And one in Kalinga, sir, the Lubuagan Batong Buhay to Abra Road. Again, we expect this to be open tomorrow at 5 p.m. And then the one yung nasa picture, sir, na close pa rin, the Baguio Bontoc Road. Our target is July 30 namin ma-open yun, sir. And sir, with your instruction, in fact, may mga yung kasama pala sa assessment team natin na dinispatch ni Secretary Bunuan, kasama yung mga consultants, ng foreign consultants. So I'd like to inform our local governments here in Abra, yung Katahira and Sons, they have a team that went here this morning also to help us in the assessment of the extent of the damage.
Paano naman meron kayong report sa mga tulay? The Vice Governor was showing me pictures of damaged bridges.
Yes, sir. Yung mga na-report na damage, sir, mostly on the approach, sir. So, madali na lang yung intervention, sir. Structurally, stable naman yung mga bridges natin along our national roads.
Medyo, yung pinakita mo sa akin, may malaking crack na ganito, all half a meter wide na crack.
It's located in the Baay Bridge in Lag Abra Kalinga Road, sir.
At saka yung what was the other bridge yung umurong sa sa approach?
Yes, sir.
Hindi na parehong
level. We are waiting for the yung result ng assessment ng ating structural engineer, sir.
All right. Well, again, of course, that's very important, you get all those bridges back into service. I think you're doing as well as can be done dito sa pag-clearing ng mga kalsada. Malalaki yung mga bato na nakita natin. All right, so we have to organize also, I guess, local government, kasi kayong mga staff, ang mga staff ninyo magagamitin. Paano na kung hindi naman injured yung mga evacuee, paano natin, as soon as possible, maibalik? Kaya tinanong ko na kung kailan tayo pwedeng pumasok sa mga bahay para maibalik sila sa bahay nila. And for those that have damage, do we need to provide, usually, at least for temporarily, mga hinihingi nyo, mga trapal, mga GI sheet, plywood, mga 2x2, yun lang mga para meron lang sa kagaya mga bubong na nasira, at least makubera nila habang i-repair para pwede na sila makatira doon. But the first part is going to be really kung it's safe. We have to determine that it's safe. And
Until when po kaya, Mr. President? Kasi most of the families are on the streets or they use the camping tents outside their houses. Mm. So they are waiting for us, for our advisory, kung kailan ulit sila papasok sa bahay nila.
Isaac Solido, maybe you can guide us.
Ang pinaka-importante po, Vice Gov, is ma-inspect ng mga engineers kung structure ni sound yun. Kung walang sira, mas candidate na bumalik agad. Basta masigurado na structurally safe. Kasi yung ibang may sira, baka matuluyan sa aftershock.
But the fear you said is that baka sibuluan nila yung pag-inspeksyon, abutan naman sila ng aftershock.
Usually po, sa labas muna
sila. Baka masaktan pa sila.
Usually sa labas muna. Tinitingnan muna. From the outside, that's the first phase. May mga visual inspection po ang mga engineers ng public works. At kung may candidate na delikado, siyempre, hindi na muna pa babalikin yan.
Alright. Ganun talagang tendency, ayaw iwanan yung bahay as much as possible. So we just allowed, we do everything to bring them back in sa... So who will do the inspection? Will be the local government or the DPWH? Sino mag-i-inspect ng ito, mga residences na ito? Kayo sa public works o sa local ang usually na ano?
Yung sa for the residents, sir, local na yun, sir.
Maybe you can give it.
But of course, sir, DPWH is always, we're here to, we can assist naman.
If the national government will provide some technical assistance.
Sige, sir.
Oo. Yes, kasi ilan ang engineer mo sa ano sa Capitolio?
Yes, if I may, Mr.
Yes,
President,
and I may.
Yes, regarding inspection and structural integrity and soundness, since Region 1 is present here, I just came from Ilocos Sur, Manong Chavit is here. The destruction among the heritage churches, for example, is overwhelming. We inspected Bantay, the Vigan Cathedral, as well as Kaunayan Church. They are or should be condemned shortly. However, it is known to us that the public works, for example, is hardly competent to assess the integrity of these centuries-old churches. May I encourage the speaker being here that the budget be put aside for proper structural integrity that is non-destructive. I have done this. At least I've got a bill for it for Paway Church before. Medyo mahirap-hirap siya, highly technical. May rebound hammer test, ultrasonic pulse velocity, electromagnetic cover, meter test, Windsor probe, and on and on and on. You have to contract specialists for this. But clearly for heritage churches, this is necessary. Secondly, I'd also like to pitch here that much of the infrastructure really in Region 1, CAR, and Region 2 is over 50 years old, which by international standards is ancient and should be replaced.
Sir, may I?
Mr. President.
Yes, please, go ahead. Renan.
Hi. Good morning, sir, Mr. President. RD Ronel Tanpo from Region 1. Actually, yung instruction nga po ni Secretary, tulungan namin yung local. Actually, ginakandak na po namin sa mga national buildings yung assessment sa lahat, including bridges. Ay susunod na po namin na tulungan yung local na mga residences na ano yung kanilang structural integrity ng kanilang buildings. Actually, kahapon pa po, nag-start na kami lahat ng national buildings, in-start na namin. With regards po dun sa mga, dito naman po sa Region 1, minimal lang yung damage. At least yung pong as reported, nasa for the infrastructure, mga 35 million lang po yung ano. At yung pong nabanggit na tulay, yung Kalumbuyan, Anduyan, at mga ano lang po yan, sir, mga slow protection lang, and may mga papalitan lang parts yung tulay para restore na po sa dati. And with regards to also to Region 1, doon sa road na sarado, tatlong road section lang po sa Region 1 ang sarado, itong Tagudin Cervantes sa bahagi ng Soyo. na dahil sa dami ng rock slides, mga next week pa ho namin matatapos. Pero po yung dalawang road section na kadugsong nito, yung papuntang Aluling at papunta ng Bontok, ma-open ho namin hanggang bukas. Matitira lang po yung isa. Pero may mga blasting po kasi may ginagawa. Kaya medyo may backup na rin pong mga equipment na dila ang regional office para mabackupan yung district engineering office. With regards dun po sa lock, wala naman hong reported pagdating sa water supply na damage sa bahagi. Wala hong nire-report sa amin.
And with the disconnection in the signal there, we just saw live the briefing of ABRO officials to President Ferdinand Marcos as he visited the province one day after the magnitude 7 quake. Marcos personally checked on the condition of those injured and affected by the quake and sympathized with the family of the person who died in the tremor. Benguet Mayor Dominic Valera saying he is grateful for the rapid assistance provided the quake-hit province. NDR RMC Assistant Secretary Bernardo Alejandro reported 5 dead and 131 injured and over 20,000 individuals affected due to the quake. Aftershocks ranging from magnitude 1.5 to 5.4 in intensity, and FEVOC says this could continue for several weeks. Cost to damage to infrastructure now estimated at 33.8 million pesos in Ilocos region alone. 349 houses have been damaged, 28 totally damaged, and DPWH engineers will have to conduct inspections before clearing residents to come home. Meanwhile, the Social Welfare Department says over 2,000 families or more than 8,314 individuals are evacuees and are in modular tents in open areas, some in basketball courts. 469 families in 110 areas in Regions 1 and Car are also affected in the quake. Food packs have been pre-positioned in provinces in anticipation of possible floods and further landslides in the coming days. Meanwhile, 3 of 22 roads affected by the quake remain impassable and closed to traffic in the Cordillera region and blocked by huge boulders. Public works officials are targeting to open all roads by July 31st. 61 damaged schools and 116 classrooms have also been damaged in the quake. An assessment of the damage to agriculture continues. Senator Amy Marcos says some areas in the Ilocos and Cagayan regions are still without power following the quake, although all 26 towns of ABRA have power, but power has not yet been restored in some isolated areas. The DILG, meanwhile, has also brought portable water purification systems to ABRA. The president also ordered the procurement of water purification systems. The Office of Civil Defense says Japan has offered assistance in search, rescue, and retrieval operations. Response to the catastrophe is being managed from the local and national level. Senator Marcos, meanwhile, also proposed to the House Speaker that budget be set aside to assess the damage on historical heritage sites and replace structural systems that are hundreds of years old. And that's the latest from ABRA. We'll bring you more details from President Marcos's visit to Quake-hit Luzon in the coming hours. I'm Rain Musngi. Stay on ANC.
Be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no, and we have allowed more.